Greetings to everyone. Namaste. Welcome to VTU eShikshana program, Visveshwaraya Technological University, Belagavi. We are going to look at the course Building Services 3, dealing with air conditioning, mechanical transportation, and fire protection with the code 18ARC 6.3 for the BR discipline 6th semester. Session being April to August 2021. I, Dr. Dakshani R. Patil, I am architect and urban designer, currently working as associate professor at BMS College of Architecture, Bull Temple Road, Bengaluru. So we have been doing few sessions prior to this under the course Building Services 3 and modules 1 and 2, which deal with mechanical ventilation and air conditioning. Module 1 deals with introduction and few fundamental principles governing the mechanical ventilation. Module 2 will deal with air conditioning systems and various architectural perspectives of the same. So again, we will begin with a recap or understanding overview of the syllabus. We have the objective of understanding the mechanical services in buildings in this particular course and how we integrate it with the architectural design perspectives. Module 1, mechanical ventilation and air conditioning, in which we have already done the classes for introduction to mechanical ventilation, definition, understanding the need for mechanical ventilation in buildings, some of the standards by ASHRAE, NBC, and the types of mechanical ventilation systems which we can adopt as required or as found suitable in different typology of the buildings. Then the second section of the module 1 talks about introduction to air conditioning in terms of a basic fundamentals, terminologies, the science of psychrometric processes, and plotting the charts called as psychrometry charts. So much we have seen in the previous classes. In this current session, we will look at air and refrigeration cycles. Alright, so we are slowly inching towards understanding the air conditioning system, and air conditioning systems are based on the fundamental refrigeration processes. So that is what we will look at, and ahead we have load calculations to understand, zoning and air distribution, heating systems. Further, we will move on to module 2, which will deal with the air conditioning systems, various types, and the intricacies or detailing about the same. Alright, so let us begin the session, and a quick overview of the references listed in the library, and of which NBC, National Building Code, and IS codes are a must for any architect to be acquainted with. Also, I would suggest another reference by Edward Peter on air conditioning principles and systems, an energy approach, the fourth edition, which was released in 2002. So we will always come back to some of these literature references, theoretical basis as we proceed ahead. So commencing with module 1, section number 2, hence I will call it as 1.2, and the main premise of the module is refrigeration processes and refrigeration cycle. So briefly, what this current discourse will address: the concept of refrigeration and the process, refrigerant, which is a fluid, that's a very important aspect of the refrigeration process. Two types of refrigeration cycles we will look at: vapor compression refrigeration and vapor absorption refrigeration cycles. Further to that, heat pump and briefly the cooling towers. So this is what we will expect to understand and acquaint ourselves in this particular class session. Refrigeration. This is a word which we very often we come across in the mechanical ventilation or air conditioning discipline. It's a branch of science. Lot of physics comes into action here, and very technically sound aspect, which has been evolving since the last one century when it was invented, and lots of new innovations are coming into this. The most commonly aspect which we can connect is the refrigerator in our houses, what we colloquially call as fridge, based on the most basic fundamental principle. So how do we define refrigeration? Refrigeration is defined as any scientific process of reducing and maintaining the temperature of a space or material below the temperature of the surroundings. So is it clear? We will slowly understand the aspect. It's a scientific process. And what does the process aim at doing? It aims to reduce the temperature of a given material or a space. Reduce it with respect to what? With respect to the temperature of the surroundings. So whenever we wish to keep, maintain an object or a space at a lower temperature compared to the outside, it is called as the process of refrigeration. And this entire gamut of refrigeration is reliant on a fluid which we will call as refrigerant. Okay? It's like the blood in a human body, and the function it does is move around, circulate, and take care of the process of refrigeration. So understanding refrigerants is a critical part of the process of refrigeration. Now, before we actually plunge into understanding the process, we will look at what are the applications of refrigeration under various sectors or building technology. So the most basic aspect that we all, you and I, will come across is the domestic refrigeration in terms of the fridge, which keeps our vegetables, fruits, food cooler and prolonged safer for a certain amount of time. So this box refrigerator, fridge, is going to keep the objects which is inside it cooler than what is the outside temperature. Commercial refrigeration. So domestic refrigeration was a small unit confined. Commercial refrigeration is at a large scale. It holds and displays frozen and fresh food in retail outlets, restaurants, hotels. So in commercial buildings which require this kind of a refrigeration, it is adopted, and it is to a larger scale. So the setup is bigger, the machinery or the equipment is large scale, and the capacity also is larger. Third application, we will call it as comfort air conditioning. So air conditioning is a advanced mechanical ventilation system by which we condition the air inside a room, inside a space, inside a building. So we wish to keep the indoor environment cooler, cleaner than what is outside. So we control the temperature, pressure, humidity. So when this air conditioning aims at keeping the indoor environment ambient for human comfort. So when people are the objective for providing this air conditioning, it is called as comfort air conditioning, because the AC aims to give comfort to its users or inhabitants. So comfort air conditioning is also based on refrigeration, and one of the most important applications of this science of refrigeration, right? So comfort air conditioning is another application base of refrigeration. Moving on, air conditioning again becoming or having larger implication, industrial AC, and the objective of this AC is not people per se, but the processes for manufacturing, for various activities of production or engineering the goods. So industrial AC has also its bearing on the refrigeration as a basic fundamental process, and its objective is in buildings which are hosting activities for production, industrial activities, manufacturing, etc. So we have to know these differences because the systems vary, the capacities vary, objectives vary. But the point to note is refrigeration is the basic principle on which this will work. Industrial refrigeration, another application. Why is it used? It will run with the objective for chemical processings, like where medicine or such testing happens, breweries, oil refineries, cold storage, etc. So it is aiming at controlling the environment or that particular aspect of cooling than what is outside. The cooling degrees are quite at a lower range. The industrial AC was about maintaining an ambient indoor temperature so that the machineries and the engineering aspect works. Industrial refrigeration will take care of the maintenance of the products or the outcome of the industrial processes at a cooler temperature, cooler and cleaner. Then another application would be the marine and transport refrigeration. So what does this mean? Now we have industrial AC refrigeration, or a building which is producing these kind of goods or products, and the market for the same would be kilometers away from the site of production, and you need to take this product at such an ambient temperature to the point of market. So we will adopt modes of transportation which adopt or which have this refrigeration integral to them. They keep or they transport the goods from the point of production to the market or the destination points. So these equipment that are required to preserve and store the goods while they are on the move, and they could be transportation modes by rail, road, air or sea. So these are the important or very evident applications of refrigeration, and these imply directly to the architecture or design of the buildings. Now, how do we measure the refrigeration per se. What is the unit? All the measurements have, all the parameters have certain unit of measurement. So what is the unit of measurement of refrigeration? We call it ton of refrigeration and indicated as TR. TON, sometimes also TONNE. So ton of refrigeration is the unit of refrigeration. Now we will define the term. Ton of refrigeration is defined as the quantity of heat to be removed from the object or space in order to form 1 ton of ice. 1 ton is equivalent to 1000 kgs. So 1 ton of ice at 0 degrees Celsius in the time period of 24 hours from liquid water at 0 degrees Celsius. So very systematically defined unit. We have to understand the various parameters here. So basically, what is it? It is a quantity of heat. It is a quantum of heat. Okay. What is this quantum of heat about? That has to be removed from the object or space or room. Okay. The room which we are planning to cool down. So in order to, what is the comparative analysis? In order to remove one, to form 1 ton or 1000 kgs of ice, so you have to cool the temperature or remove the heat to such an extent that it forms 1 ton of ice at 0 degrees Celsius. So that is the unit measurement in 24 hours from liquid water at 0 degrees Celsius. So very beautifully conceptualized definition of the unit. And these are the values or conversion factors or equivalent factors. So 1 TR, 1 ton, 3.5 kilojoules per second or 3024 kilocalories per hour or 12,000 British thermal units per hour. So that is the conversion factor of 1 TR, that is ton of refrigeration. So if you happen to take a quick look or glance at the AC unit anywhere in your home or office or college, and you just look at what is the capacity of that particular unit AC, you will see it is as in terms of ton, probably a window AC which is somewhere between 1 ton to 1.5 ton, right? So you can do that exercise and look at the specification or what is the tonnage of the AC unit that you are looking at, or even when you go to supermarket at the refrigeration unit that is kept, you can just as a side exercise look at the specification and how much is the capacity of that refrigeration. It would be a good practical exercise to carry on. So shall we move ahead? Yes, this is a very important component or ingredient of refrigeration, the refrigerant. It is basically a fluid to transfer heat in a refrigeration system. So, a fluid medium that is adopted to transfer heat in a refrigeration system. So transfer heat, because we will recollect here, heat as per the thermodynamic law cannot be generated or destroyed. So when you say I want to cool this object or a room, it doesn't mean you're destroying the heat there. You will be transferring it from that point to something else. So our very noble refrigerant is taking that course of removing the heat or transferring the heat from point A to point B. What does the refrigerant do? It will absorb heat at very low temperatures, pressures, and reject the same at higher temperature and pressure, involving a change of state of the fluid. Very beautifully, if this line is understood, it is how battle won. So what is the refrigerant, or what is the integral characteristic of refrigerant? It should absorb heat at very low temperatures and pressure, which is very rare, and it should reject the same at higher temperature pressure, involving a change in its state. So it's going to become fluid, liquid to vapor, vapor to liquid, very easily, with much less effort. So it has to boil at very low temperature. Please remember this and register this in your minds, the crucial characteristic of a refrigerant, as low as minus 40 degrees Celsius. So we have to have that kind of a substance which has this characteristic. One of the examples is ammonia. Actually, when the whole concept of refrigeration started, ammonia was the first element that has seen its application, and very wonderfully ahead various other elements also started to be invented and applied. So what are the various properties of ideal refrigerant? We will look at that now, and this is a very important aspect, because we have to know the chemical properties of a refrigerant so that it is qualifying as a refrigerant in a refrigeration system. So first most important thing, it's like the at the top of this pyramid, it has to boil at very, very low temperatures. This is a very integral property of a good refrigerant. Simultaneously, it should have a very low freezing point. Very two crucial properties of a good refrigerant. Further, it has to be non-poisonous or non-toxic, non-explosive, non-corrosive. Now think about it. It is something which is in a system that we are having in our workspaces or living spaces. Okay, this liquid is going to be contained in that particular appliance or equipment, and there are chances that this particular fluid gives up some kind of a residual in terms of oozing out the gas or liquid. So we are in direct contact with this, and when such encounters happen, it has to definitely be non-poisonous. So when we are breathing something, when we are touching something, there has to be that safety factor. So this refrigerant has to be ideally a non-toxic element. Non-explosive, definitely it is in a system, in an appliance which is running on power, and there is a cycle happening in it. So it has to have the non-explosive characteristic. Non-corrosive, because it's running in metal pipes, copper pipes, right? So if it starts corroding that, then there is no point. It is just going to hamper the system. So it has to be non-corrosive. Odorless, colorless, definitely. You just imagine if it leaks and it stains and it creates a lot of clumsy outcome, which is not a compatible thing, comfortable thing. So odorless, the smell, colorless. It should be stable at a wide range of temperature and pressure. You will have to remember this, because ahead we are going to see the refrigeration cycle, and it will imply how there is a very rapid change between high temperature pressure to low temperature pressure. Very quick transformations have to happen. And this transformation shouldn't happen in such a way that the refrigerant loses its properties or changes to something else. That's why it has to be stable at a wide range of temperature and pressure. It should be chemically inert, almost meaning the similar thing. So it should not decompose nor break down or change into something else, some other element, because of the chemical reaction. It has to be stable and chemically inert. Low viscosity, definitely, because it's moving constantly in that cycle. Low viscous characteristic is important. It has to be environmentally friendly. Now, this is something which is a very tricky word here, because if we look at the background or history of refrigerants, they have been one of the most hazardous elements to the environment. We will see why that is so ahead. They are one of the primary reasons for the depletion of ozone layer. So now we are proposing that they be environmental friendly. It has to be economic, pertaining that a minimum requirement of the quantity of refrigerant adopted to achieve a good amount of unit refrigeration. Right? So, say you are using a vehicle and that keeps demanding a very high consumption of petrol to just cover 1 kilometer. It becomes uneconomical. You cannot keep on doing that. So, in a similar way, this refrigeration cycle runs with the refrigerant, and we cannot keep on investing or consuming it to produce the required refrigeration level. So it has to be economical, meaning minimum quantity required to produce a substantial refrigeration output. So few more points ahead on refrigerant. We will understand the environmental angle to it. Most widely, refrigerant is used in compressors, and they are in a chemical group called as fluorinated hydrocarbons or hydrocarbons. So these refrigerants that are generally adopted or used fall in this chemical group of hydrocarbons, and they are in use since 1930s, right? Almost a century now, because they were found suitable. So the scientists, R&D research happened, and it was found that these are the suitable refrigerants, hydrocarbons. So they are CFCs, fluorinated carbon elements, and we call them as CFC-11 chlorofluorocarbons, CFC short form, 11, CFC-114, and to make them easier to understand, the industry used the words R11, R12, R114, so easy to connect. Then came hydrochlorofluorocarbons, and which one of the examples is R123. Then most recently, HFCs R134A, R125, which are sort of in the safer range in the usage with respect to the environment. Now, I just mentioned priorly about ozone depletion. Now, stratosphere, troposphere, then there is a ozone layer above us. Okay. Now, how does this refrigerant in our refrigeration system or AC impacting the depletion of the ozone? So you all can have a nice reading on this, very popularly published on the media. Please do that. Briefly, we will take a look here. So refrigerants are an extremely serious environmental concern, especially the CFCs. These are the reasons for impacting the ozone layer, which is protecting our Earth. So what is the importance of this ozone layer It is about 7 to 8 kilometers, I guess, and it is like a safety cover around our Mother Earth. So it is protecting the Earth from the harmful UV rays. Okay, UV rays and such intricate rays which are arising from the sun in the solar rays, which are very harmful to the skin and to humans. So this ozone layer is taking care of this and reflecting those layers back and not letting them up to us. And the CFCs that we are using, they give out chlorine. One chlorine item can destroy 1 lakh ozone molecules. So imagine this tiny item traveling all the way up to the ozone layer. It takes quite a substantial number of years. So something that happened 30 years back, the refrigeration then, might be impacting the ozone layer at this point of time. So that is the criticality. The time lapse is quite substantial, and we started to realize this only after, say, 20, 30 years into using the refrigeration. So ozone depletion, it leads to very harmful impact on humans, skin cancer, eyes impacting cataract, immunity reduction, also not just to humans, but they are harmful to the crop and other life, other living organisms. So that is the criticality here. Similarly, the combustion given out by vehicles, burning of fuels, coal, etc., many other nuclear activities, all these are leading to the ozone depletion. That's why somewhere in 1987, the Montreal Protocol was held. So this was a very involuntary participation by various nations, the developed and the developing and underdeveloped. They met at Montreal to take stock of this damage to the ozone layer, 1987, back then. And there were lots of decisions taken to protect our environment, and one of them was phasing out the usage of refrigerants in our refrigeration systems, in ACs, in cars. So there was a deadline given that we have to phase out from using these harmful refrigerants for a given amount of time. So developing countries like the US have already phased out. Developing countries were given time up to, say, 2010 or so to phase out, and but they're still in the process. And there is a very, very strong, rigorous research happening to look for better alternatives of refrigerants, like halocarbon refrigerants, HCF 134A is one of the examples which can be adopted. So developing countries like us are almost on the verge of phasing out, but there is one more lap to go there so that we can totally come out of this harmful refrigerants used in the refrigeration cycle. Now this table gives an overview of some of the refrigerants that we use: R12, R22, or R5O2, ammonia, etc., and where they are used. So the domestic refrigeration or the freezers relies on R12. Small retail supermarkets, R12, R22, R5O2. Air conditioning systems of various scales, R11, R12, 22, 144, 502. Industrial processing or refrigeration uses ammonia as well. Ammonia has one negative aspect, the odor. Hence, it is confined to industrial usages. Transport refrigerations, R112, R502. So the list is there. These are some of the indications or examples of the refrigerants that are used. These are chemically, chemical names are quite difficult. So the industry has come out with this kind of a nomenclature for easy connection to the refrigerants.